Athletic pubalgia, aka a sports hernia, can be very difficult for a lot of people to diagnose. Healthcare providers have trouble with it, certainly patients do. How can you expect to treat it properly if you don't know how to diagnose it properly? Today we're covering a literature paper where they talked to and examined 245 people to see what they had in common when they had athletic pubalgia, aka a sports hernia, aka groin pain in athletes. First, they took a little survey to figure out what the most prevalent sport was going to be. Here's what they found. They found soccer was the main sport with 129 participants, followed by running and gym workouts, with running being 43 and gym workouts being 16 subjects of the 245. Altogether, these sports accounted for 76.7% of the entire sample of people. Now, this isn't to say you can't get it doing other things, but these are the commonalities that they all had. Now we can go into the symptoms. Be aware that symptoms are not always pain. The symptoms can also be tightness, burning, stabbing, shooting, tightnesses in the testicle if you're a male. So remember, this is a symptoms we're talking about. We're not talking about necessarily only pain. So symptoms improved at rest and worsened during the practice of the sport, running or walking. Another 13% had pain during sexual intercourse, 11% during sneezing, 8% during coughing. We also saw that it worsened during change of direction activities, during long runs, sprints, and speed training, jumps, and kicks. Most patients had pain in the inguinal region, which is the crease of the hip, right as your thigh meets your abdominal area. Some had it into the adductor muscles and some into the pubic bone region right in the middle. Other affected sites were the lumbar spine or the low back, the proximal thigh, proximal meaning upward thigh, kind of high thigh area, the perineum, which is the area between the thighs, and the testes, which is the genitals in men. When we got into the physical exam portion, it seemed like they mainly had two things in common. And this is the first starting point to figure out what the person has, what images possibly to take, and see if we can find a pattern to actually treat the person too. So imaging is not always first on the list, it's usually these. So what we found was the adductor contraction against resistance with an extended knee was positive and painful in 190 patients of the 245. Also, simultaneous unilateral, which is single side, hip and abdominal contraction against flexion, or flexion against resistance rather, in 188 of the 245 patients. And if we reference back up into the results in the original section of the literature, we can see that both of those tests had over 75% relationship with people having this type of condition. By the way, if you're looking for any information about how to actually resolve this condition, the step-by-step process, we have our sports hernia six-step recovery plan that is free in the link description below. Check that out. Interesting, many people in this literature actually waited a really long time to find the correct diagnosis. We see that 118 of those 245 had the diagnosis established in less than 90 days from the original pain onset, which is actually not too bad. But we can see that another 127 of those 245 actually didn't get the diagnosis confirmed until after 90 days from onset of injury, which is quite a bit of time. Why does this happen? We can use a simple Google search to figure out what the other possibilities are. And you can see by this list here, there's many different things that can masquerade around as a simple sports hernia. Adductor tendonitis, osteitis pubis, inguinal hernias, muscle strains in the groin, hip joint pathologies such as labral tears, impingement, iliopsoas, tendonitis, snapping hip syndrome, and the list goes on and on and on. Now that we cover basically what people look like and the symptoms and testing that is relevant for a athletic pubalgia or sports hernia case, let's talk about the basic treatment plans. This paper from 2013 covers a basic rundown of what sports hernia management looks like from a bird's eye view. Here it says, if we're highly suspicious of a sports hernia, it's recommended to start a trial of non-operative management immediately. At this point, neither further imaging nor referral to a specialist is required. I think that's an important part because a lot of people do wait a very long time wondering if the image or another specialist referral is needed. In this section, it describes non-operative management. In this case, it says non-operative management consists of a combination of rest, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, corticosteroid injections, and physiotherapy. A trial of non-operative treatment should be investigated for all patients presenting with symptoms consistent with a sports hernia for a period between 6 to 12 weeks. When the patient is pain-free following this, they should attempt to return to sport. If they're unsuccessful, possibly operative intervention should be considered. We're not talking about surgery in this video, but just know that there is non-operative options for you. We don't use a medicative approach. We're not allowed to, it's not our expertise, but we specialize in the physical medicine approach. So we help people identify safe and productive exercises and stretches for their condition so they get back into the sport sooner and hopefully don't have a re-aggravation as they start to ramp up activity. If this was helpful to you guys, please like and subscribe to the channel. You can always reach out to us. We have virtual and in-person services, and make sure to check out that free resource in the description for the video. Take care.